Good morning, friends. Today we will discuss about what is a strong entity and what is a weak entity. Okay, so now what is meant by weak entity or strong entity means, before discussing what is a strong entity and weak entity, I want to discuss what is a key attribute. Now, as I said earlier, for an entity we will have an attributes. What is an entity? Entity is a real-time world object. Okay, real world object. So the example is student. Student is a real world object. Okay, whereas student will have some properties. Student, to distinguish a student, we need some properties. Those properties we'll call it as an attribute. Or attribute is a property to describe about an entity. Okay, set of properties. Now, if you see that attributes, we have different types of attributes. Okay, one of that attribute we'll call it as a key attribute. What is meant by key attribute? Using that attribute, you can uniquely identify a student in the students list. Let me discuss again. We have a student entity. Now, student entity will have so many students. If using the one of that attribute, you can uniquely identify a student, then we will call that attribute as a key attribute. Let's take an example that student will have a roll number. Using the roll number, we can uniquely identify a student inside the class. Is it clear? So, for the key attribute for the student entity is the roll number or student ID. So, now what is meant by strong entity? An entity which consists of a key attribute, we will call it as a strong entity. Now, let's take that student table. Our student entity has certain attributes. One of that attribute is student ID. He has student name. Okay. So, he has several attributes. I have distinguished only student ID and student name. Now, as we said earlier, student ID is a key attribute. So, the key attribute will be represented like this. Means using the oval shape, it will represent it as a line. So, this one we will call it as a key attribute. Now, if an entity consists of a key attribute, that entity we will call it as a strong entity. Now, you can easily say, what is a weak entity? An entity which does not consist of key attribute, we will call it as a weak entity. Okay? So, I think you have understood the basic difference between strong entity and weak entity. Now, you can ask me, sir, how the entity will be does not consist of a key attribute. Using something we can uniquely identify, then where is the entity we will get which does not have a key attribute, so that we can call it as a weak entity. Let me discuss with an example. As we said earlier, in an institute we have some faculty. Okay, so faculty is one entity, or let me take like this, there are certain number of faculties are there. Okay, and their dependents. Usually whenever you join any government organization, okay, they will ask who are your dependents. Why they will ask you who are your dependents is, whatever the medical insurance you are taking, all these things, the dependents, for dependents you will take care. And suppose in a government organization, if you have a kid, they will give some education money for every year. So there are some benefits for the dependent. So whenever you join in any government organization or some well-reputed organization, they will ask the dependent list. And even they have some certain criteria, those people only can come into the dependents. Okay. Now let's take that there is a faculty 1, faculty 2, faculty 3, faculty 4. Now remember one point. Every faculty does not need to have some dependents. Is it clear? There are some faculty who does not have any dependents. Is it clear? He is a bachelor and he is an orphan. Let's take an example. Okay. He is an orphan, so he will not have any parents or anyone. He is unmarried, so obviously he will not have the next generation and the old generation also. Then we can say that he does not have a dependents. Or let's take another example. Because of some criteria, they have kept these criteria. Their income should be less than 10,000, all these things. In that case also, a faculty may not have any dependent. So, it is not compulsory that each faculty will have a dependent. But the reverse is that, if there is a dependent, he should be have a relationship with any one of the faculty. Otherwise, he will not come into the dependents list. and a later run. If you have a dependent 1, dependent 2, dependent 3, what is I want to say is that if he comes in the dependent list, then obviously he should have a relation with someone. Let's take that faculty 2 has 2 dependents. Okay, faculty 2 has 2 dependents and faculty 3 has 1 dependent. Are you able to understand? Okay, so what I want to say is that every faculty need not to have a dependence, but whoever the dependents are there, they should have a relationship with at least one faculty. Is it clear? So that's why dependent 1 and dependent 2 have a relation with faculty 2. Dependent 3 have a relation with faculty 3. Now you can ask me, sir, how can we cannot distinguish a dependent? Let's take a small example. A dependent has dependent name, okay, dependent name, then dependent years and the relation with the faculty. There is a dependent name called Raju. Let's take it. His age is some 30. Okay, he is relation with the faculty is, let's take it, he is father. Okay, if he is father of a faculty, his age should be some 45. Let's take it, his age is 45. Okay, so he is a father of some employee whose age is 45 and his name is, the dependent name is Raju. Okay, and similarly, let's take that there is can be another Raju. Okay, his age is some 10. Is it clear? He is a brother of or son of brother or son of some faculty. That is also possible. Is it clear? This Raju, let's say that he is a father of faculty F1. Okay, Raju, whose age is 45, he is having a father. Now Raju, whose age is 10, he is a brother of another faculty. Now if I want to have a key attribute on dependent name, can I have it? No. If I say Raju, two persons will come. Now can I take it as a age as a key attribute? No. Maybe there is another person whose age is 10 also will be there. So if I say 10, I will get 2 tuples. If I say take the relationship, obviously it is not possible because there can be n number of fathers, there can be n number of brothers in the dependent list. So we cannot take the key attribute as dependent name, age and relation, anything. So we can call that this dependent does not have any key attribute. So we can call this dependent entity as a weak entity, whereas faculty will have faculty ID as a key attribute. So faculty is the strong entity. Are you able to understand? Because each faculty or each employee, they will give an employee ID. Okay, then you can ask me, sir, you are saying employee ID will be there, why not the dependent for the dependent ID will be there? Usually they will not give any dependent ID because they will not come to the organization and show this ID card, yeah, I am dependent of someone. No, they are does not have any ID or identity card, so we cannot able to distinguish a unique tuple using any attribute. So in this case, faculty is a strong entity, dependent is a weak entity. Okay, now let me discuss how the relationship will be there between a strong entity and a weak entity. Okay, so that you will understand in a better way. Let's take that, as we said earlier, we have a faculty whose entity is a strong entity and we have a dependent. We have a dependent whose entity is a weak entity. Now remember one thing, always the weak entity will be represented as a double rectangle, whereas a strong entity we will represent like this. Weak entity will be represented like this. This is a weak entity. Okay. Now we will have a relation. Okay. Faculty depends on, we can take it, faculty depends on some dependent. Okay. This is the relationship they have. Now it is a weak entity and this is a strong entity. Remember one thing, whenever you are having a relationship between a strong entity and a weak entity, that relationship we will call it as an identifying relationship. Is it clear? between two strong entities we can call it as a simple relationship, whereas if you have a relationship between strong entity and a weak entity, that relationship we'll call it as a identifying relationship. So the identifying relationship will be represented like this, two diamonds, double diamond. Okay, so this one we'll call it as an identifying relationship. Okay, are you able to understand? So strong entity will be represented like this, weak entity will be represented like this, identifying relationship will be represented like this. Now, can you tell me about the participation? Okay, and the cardinality ratio, all these things we will discuss. Now, cardinality ratio I want to talk. Now, a faculty can have a relationship with more than one dependent. Am I right or wrong? In the previous case, if you see that faculty 2 have two dependents, dependent 1 and dependent 2. So, if you have a single faculty, he will have all the dependents. Suppose in your organization, only one faculty is there. Okay, whatever the dependent list came, he will be the dependents. Means these are the people who are depend on the faculty one. Let's take an example. Meaning is that what I want to say is that there may be a situation that all the dependents belongs to a single faculty. Okay, so what is the cardinality of the faculty? What is meant by cardinality? Maximum relations he can have with an other entity. Suppose if you see that faculty 1 is having maximum relation with n entities in the entity set called as dependent. So we can say that the cardinality of the faculty is n. What is the cardinality of the dependent? A dependent can have a relationship with how many members maximum? He can have only one. He is having a, he is dependent on someone. Okay, is it clear? He can say that he is a dependent on someone. Now someone will ask me. I will tell the another scenario also. Now there is a two faculties, faculty 1 and faculty 2. Okay, you will say that faculty 1 is some Ravi and faculty 2 is some Sanjana or something I'm taking. They are husband and wife. Faculty 1 and faculty 2 are husband and wife. So obviously husband and wife may have some kids. Suppose let's take the D1 is the kid of the faculty 1 and faculty 2. Then you will ask me, sir, D1 will have a relationship with F1 and also D1 will have a relationship with F2 also. You will say, but whenever you take any organization, when they ask the dependent list, even I can say that D1 is dependent on F1 and F2, but they are, means he is the kid of F1 and F2, but they will take only one dependent. Are you able to understand? If you have a father and mother working in the same company, you will not be dependent on both of them according to the organization. Okay, according to their organization, anyone, either your father has to give you your name in the dependent list or your mother has to give it in the dependent list. So, what I want to say is that if there is a dependent in any organization for a faculty, he will have a relationship with only one. So, if faculty has given that he is my dependent, then he will have a relation with F1, Karadi. Okay, if mother has given, he will have a relationship with F1, F2. Okay, so what I want to say is that any dependent can have a maximum relationship with only one faculty. So the dependent cardinality is 1. Okay, the cardinality of the faculty is n, dependent is 1. Now what is the participation? There is a faculty who does not have any relationship with any dependents. What is the participation? Cardinality will speak about the maximum value. Means a faculty can have a relationship with maximum how many dependents. Whereas participation says that a faculty can have minimum how many relationship he can have with the dependents. We have already discussed that there can be a one faculty who does not have any dependents. So in that case, the participation of a faculty is 0 because he will not have any relation with any of the dependents. What about the participation of the dependent? If there is a dependent, obviously he should have a relation with any one of the faculty. So I can say that the participation of the dependent is 1. Now already we have discussed, if we got the cardinality and participation, how can we draw the ER diagram? If you have does not go through those videos, I request you to go through those videos and come back to this video so that you will understand the concept in a better way. But anyway, if you see that faculty cardinality is N and weak entity dependent cardinality is 1. So lot of people will try to write like this, but this is not the right way. If you say that when you are reading, it will looks like N faculty is having a relationship with 1 dependent. No, that is not the case. 1 faculty can have a relation with N dependents. That is what I want to say. So it will be represented in reverse. The cardinality of the dependent will be represented here. The cardinality of the faculty will be represented here. So when we are reading, it can read like this. 1 faculty can have a relation with N dependents. Okay. So we have represented the cardinality ratio in the ER diagram like this. Now what about the participation? As the faculty have 0 participation, meaning is that it's not compulsory that all the faculties will participate in a relation. So what I can say, it is a partial participation, means partial number of faculties are only having a relation with dependent. So I can call this as a faculty as a partial participation. If you have a partial participation, you will represent using a single line. Now dependent is having a total participation, means all the dependents are participating in relation with some of the faculty. So we can call it as a dependent as a participating totally. So total participation we will represent like this. Total participation will be represented as double line, and partial participation will be represented like this. So we have constructed the ER diagram for our requirements. This kind of ER diagram representation, we will call it as a cardinality ratio ER diagram representation. Okay. So if you see this, I want to stress one point. Always remember one point. Whenever you have a relationship with the strong entity and the weak entity will have the total participation, but not the reverse is correct. Okay. What is the reverse? If there is a total participation, that entity need not to be a weak entity. But if there is a weak entity, if it is having a relationship with a strong entity, then obviously the weak entity will have a total participation. But not all total participations, those entities will not become as a weak entity. But if there is a weak entity, if it is having a relationship with a strong entity, that relation we will call it as an identifying relation. In identifying relation, the partial part means the weak entity will have the total participation. Okay, I hope you have understood what is a strong entity, what is a weak entity, how the weak entity will be represented, how the identifying relationship will be represented, all these things in this video. Okay, I request everyone to go through the videos in a sequence for better understanding. If you really like my teaching, I request you to like the videos, give your feedback in the comment section, subscribe to my channel and share the videos with your friends so that they will also be benefited. Thank you so much.